God is good, and all the time. Amen, amen. I heard this gentleman who had this mother who had three children, and they already grown up, and the mother was alone, and so the children decided to make a gift for the mother. The first one went and bought a really, really big house. The second one went and bought a really, really tiny car because she's alone. She doesn't have nobody else, so it will be just for her comfortable. And the third one decided to buy something special. He knew that mother doesn't like to read, but he still liked to hear the Bible. So he bought a pet and trained the pet to recite the whole Bible. And so all of them gave their gifts. And then a few months later, they get a letter from the mother. And she says, well, to the firstborn, he says, thank you for the house, but too big. To the second one, thank you for the car, but too small. And to the third one, he says, your gift is the best. The chicken tasted so good. Everybody here has dreams. And everybody here has needs. These are the two things that most of us have. Is we have needs, and we all, to some degree, have dreams. When Jesus stepped after being baptized, he had a need. The need was to eat. The dream was to rule the world. And Satan came to Jesus and said, I have a way to meet your need. And Jesus says, no, 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 that's not going to happen. I am not going to take your route. And then he says, when Jesus refused that, he says, now I have a way to help you fulfill your dream. He says, you don't have to go to the cross. Just bow before me and your dream will become a reality. I want to let you know something, that God has a way to meet your needs. And God also has a way to help you reach your dreams. But as young people who are on the way to see our needs met and to see our dreams reached for God, we must keep one thing in mind. That there is a difference between God's supply and satanic bait. Because many times before you reach your dreams and before you have your needs met, you will have to meet the devil who will offer his shortcut to getting your needs met and to having your dreams being reached. And Satan will always overpromise and underdeliver. And he will promise to give you something with the right hand, but with the left hand, as he gives you with the right hand, with the left hand he will go in and take what your life depends on. Dreams crush daily on the rock of temptation. Our prisons are overcrowded with people who refuse to resist temptation. People's lives are shattered every single day. Because when men have a dream and a man has a need, they're presented with the devil who gives them a shortcut and people fall for it. And Jesus stood there in the wilderness realizing, I am hungry. And he told the devil, he says, listen, devil, I am hungry, but I am not desperate. And therefore, I am not gonna fall for your bait. Why? Because I'm gonna wait on God's supply. And God's time is the best. I might have to wait 5 more minutes, but listen, I am gonna get my needs met by God, by God's way, and in this way, I am gonna avoid your temptation. And then Satan saw that that didn't work. He goes in and he says, but you have a dream. You have a goal. I know your purpose. You're gonna rule the world. And I know God's way to have that dream accomplished. It's kind of difficult. Why don't I give you a shortcut? And Jesus looked at him. He says, devil, I've seen how your shortcuts worked. I've seen where that shortcut brought even Adam. I've seen where those shortcuts brought you to. And guess what, Satan? I am not going to fall for a shortcut. I am going to believe there's God's way to reach those dreams. And I will wait on God's timing. The shortest way to reach my dreams is God's way. Any other way is a scam. Can somebody say amen? When I was in high school, I've seen young people try to take shortcuts. I was a nerd. I wasn't popular. I was definitely not famous. Not that I am right now. I struggled. I had a minivan. They made fun of me. And this wasn't hippie style, you know, like Jesus hippie, you know, kind of like the hippie where you minivan and, you know, and people smoke weed and all this stuff. No, no, no. My minivan was a little bit different. I was laughed at all the time. I wasn't the cool club. I didn't hang out with the people who were popular. I chose to live a different life. I had a need, like every other young person, to have a girlfriend and to have sex after a football game on Friday. I had the same need as everybody else, to feel loved, to have somebody to cherish me and tell me that I'm handsome. The devil is a liar. And I remember that many times I was tempted like everybody else, but I've chose not to take the enemy's route. I did not know where my life is going to end up. I did not know what, I didn't have much dreams. I just wanted to survive and graduate and have a job and get married. This was as big a dream as I had. I didn't plan for anything huge in my life. And as I took step after step, I remember we were made fun of in one bus. I still remember it like yesterday. We were, because we went to this church, there was one few kids, one in particular, who was twice my size, probably twice my age. He was very old. I don't know how he was still in high school, but he was a lot older. We were on the bus and they knew that we were going to this church. We didn't speak English, and what they did is they compiled all the kids to take paper and to throw paper at us in the bus. They knew we couldn't defend ourselves because we were, well, we were just two, me and Ilya, and they did that. And so, and we didn't take the paper to throw it back because, well, we were not connected well on that bus. And so we just sat there and we just endured the humiliation and everything and just went through like that. And honestly, when I went through it, and I didn't think anything great is going to happen out of my life. I didn't plan for anything great. I just wanted to survive. I look at a lot of my friends today who were friends when I was in high school, and I tried to bring them to church, and that's what I was known for. And when they would see me, they would avoid me because they knew that I'm going to try to bring them to church once again. Today I look at them, I meet them throughout my city. In a few months, it's going to be 10th year anniversary of my graduation. I'm old. And I see a lot of them who are very popular, muscular, handsome, beautiful, overweight. The car they drove, which their parents allowed them to drive when they were in high school, they no longer have. They drive a beaten up car. Many of them work minimum wage. Some have 3-4 children, but they don't have a spouse. Others, actually the same person who 10 years ago threw paper at my face on the bus, asked to rent my property. I have a few rentals. He came to ask and applied to rent the property. Well, I didn't accept him, because I told him, you have a bad record, you have a bad credit, you're broke, you don't work, you can't be renting if you, like, he's like, oh, but I know you. I was like, trust me, I know you too, brother. And you don't want me to throw this paper in your face right now. And one thing, when I was standing there at the property, one thing, it dawned on me. I'm like, I am so glad I did not fall for demonic temptation. I am so glad I did not sacrifice my future for the pleasure of today. I am so glad I did not sacrifice permanent blessing for a temporary pleasure. I look back at my life today, you know, and being married, having a beautiful wife, having God just kind of, you know, from every side sheltering, and things I didn't even dream of and things I didn't even plan for. Just kind of things came into place, things I'm not even good at, they just kind of happened. I look back in my life and I'm so glad that God's timing does work. And when you say no to the devil, listen, something is going to happen. God is going to come. And when God comes, He blesses you. The devil is going to be sorry. And the people will around you will say, you know what, wow, look what God has done. But you have to tell them that you had to pay a price. You had to wait for God's time. You know, one of the things that I never thought is a blessing in my life, that I get a chance to travel. I got a chance to travel a lot. I had a chance to be in like Disneyland. I never knew Disneyland existed. I went there as at the age of 23. Well, I decided my parents didn't take me there, so why not go reclaim your childhood at 23? And at the age of 24, I went to Universal Studios. Those things are nice. SeaWorld. I've never in my wildest dreams I've imagined that somebody would pay for this brother to go to those places for free and bless me there. That was never in my plan when I was a senior in high school, saying no to sin. That was never in my plan that this weekend to fly with my wife to Massachusetts to spend 3 days with some of the crazy people, that we get messages from them. They're like, we watch your ministry. We can't wait for you to come. Me? A guy who was skipping keyboard in class in the freshman high school at Hanford High because I was embarrassed to stand in front of a group of 25 students. When you resist temptation and you say, Satan, I know you want me to meet my needs your way, through porn, through masturbation, through sleeping with my girlfriend, through, you know, smoking weed, through all of this stuff. I know that's why you want me to feel joyful, to go to the club and get my joy on. But Satan, you know what? No way. I am going to wait on God's timing. I'd rather fall asleep depressed on Friday night than go get your joy in my life, that for which I am going to waste my future and my dreams. When you say no to your temptation, you're letting God to spoil you. Even if you have no connections, even if your English is as good as mine, even if you are an immigrant in this country, even if literally you may not have even education, but something happens when you choose not to meet your needs your way or demonic way, but God's way. And when you seek to reach your goals not your way or the culture way, but God's way, you're opening up for a God's time to spoil you while beyond your wildest dreams and imaginations. Can somebody say amen? It's okay to be hungry. It's not good to be desperate. When you are today maybe lonely and you're 24, 22, or maybe you're 14 and you feel like you are desperate for a boyfriend or a girlfriend, you need deliverance. It's okay to be hungry, but it's not okay to be desperate. Don't ever fall prey to demonic enticements. Because when devil gives you with the right hand, he will take with the left hand what your life depends on. I know a friend whom I talked to right before the service. At the age of 5, he had swollen knees. He had swollen knees for a while now, and his father decided to take him to a witch doctor. In their city, they knew a witch doctor who, quote unquote, helped people. She removed problems. So they took him to the witch doctor. She put him, and I'm not going to describe the whole ceremony because it's pretty crazy. How they baked him and kind of put eggs, raw eggs on him. I mean, nasty stuff. And she went around, chara, stuff all around him. And he sits there. This is what he told me. I didn't believe him. I still don't believe him, but he told me that. He says, as he sat there 5 years of age, mice started to come out of his knees. And all that poison that was in his knees just bursted, and the swelling was gone. And I'm like, so did she fix the problem? She says, completely. The problem was completely cured. I was like, okay. I'm like, the devil fixes people's problems. He said, well, the problem was that after that problem was fixed, the next day, half of my body was paralyzed. And for the next 5 years, I couldn't go to school. My knees were fixed. My body was paralyzed. You may say, how can somebody who is practicing witchcraft can heal people? This is how they heal people. They take the demon that brought the sickness and they put the demon that will bring destruction. They never remove the demon. They replace the demon with a stronger one. And who for that moment will take that problem that you came with, but as a result, sooner or later will bring more devastating problems into your life. Anything Satan gives, listen, he has nothing good to gift. Anything he offers is a scam, and it's not just a scam, it's a virus that destroys people's lives. 5 years, half body paralyzed, not able to go to school. Evangelist Reinhard Bonnke, who preaches the gospel in Africa. They take this little boy, they drag him to the crusade, and I've seen people half paralyzed where their hand is paralyzed and their foot is paralyzed. We've seen people here who came from Canada, a particular guy that I could think of. Literally, they have to lift his hand and they have to move this leg because it does not work. It's dead. That's exactly what happened to this boy. They go to this crusade. Half of his body is completely paralyzed because he received a healing from the devil. As they pray for him during the crusade, God completely heals him in an instant. He begins to move his arm, he begins to move his leg, and he begins to run around and walk. The next day, his dad gets paralyzed and dies. And his father died at the early age. This man survived. He's going to be here this weekend. I know him personally. When he told me this story, it reminded me once again. When Satan gives you with the right hand, whatever it is, whether it's sex, whether it's drugs, or whether it's healing, remember, he has a left hand. And his left hand is going for that which your life depends on. Can somebody say amen? We must differentiate between God's supply and Satan's bait. God wants to bless you. God wants to meet your needs. And Satan also wants to meet your needs. And the way he meets your needs, it's going to be bad. The way to reach your destiny, avoid temptation. Avoid temptation. And you will stumble into your dreams. Sometimes you might not know how to reach your destiny. You might not know what to get in high school, after high school, with college to go to. Can I give you a simple tip? Just avoid temptation. And as you're avoiding temptation, you will stumble into your destiny. Look in your life and say, you know what? This is good. God is very good. Can somebody say amen? And I'll read to you a verse. Matthew chapter 13 and verse 24 says the following. Another parable he put forth to them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed a good seed in his field. While men slept, the enemy came and sowed tares among the weed and went his way. And when the grain sprouted and produced a crop, then the tares also appeared. So the servants of the owner came and said to him, sir, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have tares? He said to them, an enemy has done this. This is a very interesting parable. Parable is an example. It's a story Jesus shared. This was a second parable. The first one was Jesus sowed about the sower and the three types of soils that get into, the seed falls into. And the second parable he shares here is about a man who has a field, and he comes and he sows good seed. Everybody say good. Everybody say good seed. He sows good seed on his ground, and the Bible says that that good seed is expected to sprout. And the next day, the servants come up, you know, maybe probably a few days later, and they notice that not only a good seed sprouted, but also some weird seeds sprouted. And they look at him and they say, are you bipolar? Did you mix things up? Do you have issues? Are you not the person that we know? Why did you sow good and bad into your field? What is this? What are you doing? And he says, I didn't do it. What do you mean you didn't do it? That's your field. We saw you sowing seed. He says, yeah, you saw me sowing good seed. But you didn't see somebody else who doesn't have a field sowed some other stuff into my field. He says, and that somebody else is an enemy. He said, oh, okay, makes sense. I want you to understand a few simple truths tonight. God is good. You are the soil. And God created everything on earth good. On the first day when God made something, he said, it is good. Second day he created something, he said, it is good. Third day he said, it is good. Fourth day, it is good. Sixth day, fifth day, everything God created, he said, it is good. Until came a time and God made you and God said, it is very good. Everything God made on this earth was good. God did not make anything bad on ninth day. Everything God made was good. And to remind you how God made you, was God came, the Bible says, to the dirt, and he scooped some dirt with his hands and he breathed life into that dirt, and there came you. When he created the sun, he never moved his finger. He just opened his mouth and he said, let there be light. And the sun came. When it came to creating you, God stooped down from his throne, came and picked up some dirt, and he got his hands involved in the dirt, and he created you with his touch. Therefore, you are always feel like you needing his touch. Why? Because you created with his touch. God created you and I. We were made good. God made us. Everything in this world he made good. He did not make anything bad. Nothing defected. God is not bipolar. God does not have these problems where just one day he's good, the other day he's bad. He doesn't go up and down in his emotions. He is constantly good. He has no bad seeds to sow, even if he would want to. He only has good seed. He sowed the good seed. And the Bible says that the enemy comes in and he sows bad seed. It's interesting that the enemy doesn't sow bad seed in his own field. The enemy has no field to sow bad seeds in. The enemy sows bad seed in God's field. Why? Because he has beef with God. Why? Because he and God, well, he's not on a good terms with God. That's what you would do if you would hate God. And he has a field and you don't. You go and sow something bad on his field. We must understand one thing about the devil. There's nothing devil created. Even the demons that follow him, they are not his creation. Even the earth that today he rules, nothing on this earth is his creation. Nothing. The air, the human mind, the animals, nothing on this earth is his. He is here and illegal because this soil belongs to God. Even the people that worship the devil today, people who practice magic and witchcraft, those people simply have bad seeds in them. They are not his. That's why many times those people will come to church and the minister of God with the fire of God will pull the weed out of them and something will happen. Those people continue to be good. We must understand one thing. When you look at every human being, when you open your eyes in the morning and you look at the beauty of nature, nothing on this earth has Satan's fingerprint on it. It's not his. Nothing is his. You are not his, even if he plants something in your life. Every person, maybe you're looking today, like you read in the Bible, one person who had 6,000 demons, lived naked, lived in the caves, and the Bible says man could not pass through that place. Why? Because most likely they attacked humans and tried to eat them. They lived like animals. 6,000 demons tormenting a man, chained up, breaking the chains and living in the caves, talking to the dead people. You will look at that person and you will say, that's not a human, that's an animal. Jesus came and he said, that person does not belong to Satan. He said, that person is a good soil. And Satan sowed some 6,000 seeds. And Jesus in a split second pulled 6,000 seeds out. And a mentally retarded person who would eat bad things, live in the caves, becomes completely sane. Gets dressed up and sits like a normal man and begs Jesus to follow him. Not one human being, no matter what they say, no matter what they do, was created or belongs to Satan. Every person he attacks is God's property. Every person he tries to destroy was made by God. Everything Satan does is perverse and twist. That's why, honestly, his job is easy. Anybody can break things. But only God can heal and only God can create things. I'm good at breaking things. You are good at breaking things. I'm good at taking things apart. And when I take them apart and put them together, the thing that did not work, there will be many, many other things that will never work again. Because that's how we are. It doesn't take a gift or creativity to break something or to take something apart. It takes a gift and creativity to put something together. And that's what my God did. Therefore, Satan is a loser. Therefore, Satan, he's an intruder. He just simply gets into somebody else's field. He doesn't have his own field. And he tries to just sow bad seeds in God's field. The devil is a liar. Our God is a good God. Can somebody say amen? I want you to notice when does Satan do this. The Bible says when man slept, he came. God is very good. But I want you to know this characteristic about the enemy. When we are most ignorant, he is most anonymous. He likes to remain anonymous. The Bible didn't say that when the servants woke up in the morning sipping their Starbucks coffee and watching the field, and boom, Satan comes, says, "Hi, y'all. My name is the devil. I am here to do some trouble." If that would have happened, they would have pulled up the rifles and shot him into smallest pieces. He would evaporate into the air. That would have never happened. If they would have seen him, I double dare you, they would have never allowed him to put his foot into that field. They would have butchered him. They would have kicked him out. He would have been looking for the fifth corner in that field, if there is a fifth corner. But see, what he does is when the man slept, the Bible says, he sneaked in and he wants to be nameless and he wants to be anonymous. It means he wants to do stuff in your life that when you wake up in the morning, you know it's God's field. And you remember God sowing things in it. And so you only remember God sowed things and you see bad. Then who do you look to? God. You look, what did you do? That's exactly the plan of the enemy. When men have problems, they know, well, God is in control. Well, everything is God's. He could have stopped the devil. And when we have bad things grow up in our life, we do what the servants do. We're like, God, well, what is this? And God looks at us and he says, I didn't do it. Who did it? Why did you allow it? And God replies back. He says, the question is, why did you allow it? When you're ignorant, he remains anonymous. Satan wants to be anonymous in people's lives. When the bombing happens in a school and kids die, we always ask a question, where was God? When a drunken kills an innocent person crossing the street, where was God? When the cancer claims a single mother's life and the kids are left orphans, we cry out, where is God? And it's a good question to ask, but we must understand God had nothing to do with it. God only sows good seed. The bad seeds did not come on accident. They're not part of just the universe having a misbalance. They are work of an enemy who wants to work anonymously. And we must not be ignorant. I know in our culture they say ignorance is a bliss. It's not. It's dangerous. It's when you're ignorant, he has an advantage. It's funny the things that we used to believe was true. Did you know that people used to believe that if you eat Chinese food, you'll be Chinese? Did you know that people used to believe that the earth is flat and if you swim long enough in the ocean, you'll fall off of it? That's one of the reasons why people never came across into our part, into northern part of America, because they were afraid if you swim too far, you will fall off. Did you know that people till this day believe that if you wave a red flag in front of a bull, that he gets, you know, provoked? The problem is the bull is actually colorblind. He doesn't see red. The problem is the flag, that it's moving things, flapping things that actually that provokes him, not the red. He's colorblind. It's funny how many things that we are completely ignorant about, and we just kind of, and you know, it is fine if you believe that eating Chinese food is going to make you Chinese. Completely cool. After you eat enough Chinese food and you realize that you don't turn Chinese, you probably snap out from that being ignorant. But there are certain things we must not be ignorant about. Can somebody say amen? There are certain things that relate to our life that we must not be ignorant about. Let me just throw a few things in your way. One of the things that we should never be ignorant about is this. If somebody practiced occult in my family, that has no effect on my life. Well, because somebody practiced occult, somebody practiced witchcraft, it has no effect on my life whatsoever. That is not true. When somebody practices occult, like we've heard from testimonies, it has an effect on your life. Or if you practice an occult, it has an effect on your life. And as a person, you must understand that it's an ignorance that Satan slips through into our life if he wants to destroy us. Getting in bed with the devil provokes God to jealousy. Anytime God mentions occult or using witchcraft or magic or anything, God always gets jealous. Why jealous? Because people who are in a relationship with Him, the best way you can provoke somebody to jealousy that you are in love with is to get in bed with somebody else. That provokes God to jealousy because people are in a covenant with Him. And we live in a generation today where people are extremely ignorant of the things of the devil. It's everywhere. And many people think there is nothing wrong with it. When it comes to voodoo, when it comes to Ouija boards, it's amazing how many people in our cell groups during the past 3 weeks have admitted to practicing witchcraft for one simple reason: curiosity and ignorance. How many people said that they played Ouija boards just for fun? How many people said that they read horoscopes like Book of Proverbs every day? It's amazing how many people simply, you know, they practice white magic or black magic. People who simply went, you know what, said, I watched Exorcism of Emily Rose. I watch all of these things and they, is it bad? And people have these questions, is it wrong? People who practice voodoo, people who just simply get involved in so many other things and they don't realize that through their ignorance, Satan slips a seed into their soil. Can somebody say amen? We must understand as Christians, we must stay away from every form of darkness. Why? Because our relationship with God is more important and we do not want to give Satan a permission to attack our lives. Can somebody say amen? You know, because of my relationship with my wife, I stay away from other women. You know, I don't hang out with other women alone. I don't drive in my car with somebody who is not my wife. I don't go to a restaurant and I don't kiss other people. Even though in some cultures, some churches I've been to, like men kiss other women like on the cheek and stuff, which is completely weird, but completely cool for them. But that's just, for me, that's just not cool. You just don't do these things. Why? Because, well, I have a wife. She's very beautiful. I love her. And plus, I just do not want other weird things happen to me. That's one of the reasons why I don't celebrate Halloween. People say, why? Not necessarily that if you celebrate Halloween, you're going to have demons. But I'm in a covenant with light, darkness. I want to stay away as far from it because I'm in love with God. And the last thing I need is another demon tormenting my life. That's one of the reasons I don't do yoga. Because everything about it is about self-exaltation. And everything is connecting to your chi. I don't want chi. I want he. We don't do horoscopes. Why? Because I got a lot of verses in the Bible. Every single day. Can somebody say amen? And this is not to brag it. This is just simply when we want to be victorious and I want to have blessing in my life, the last thing we need is to have a devil slipping in through the cracks to do all kinds of things in our life. Can somebody say amen? Another area that many people are ignorant about is the area of our sleep. For most of us, that's the area we were completely ignorant about before some of us started to watch the ministry of Prophet TB Joshua. When you have a wet dream means you wake up and you had sex in the dream. For many people, many young people, older people, well, whew, that was a bad dream. And that's about it. But then for those of us who started to listen to things and started to understand spiritual understanding, you understand, isn't that interesting that while man slept, the enemy sowed seeds? While you physically sleep, many times the enemy will come and he will sow a tear. Means he will sow a dream in your sleep. A dream, for example, somebody who died comes in a dream and starts talking to you. That's the tear. A dream, for example, that in a dream you have sex with somebody while you're married to somebody else and you wake up and that thing begins to grow and affect your relationship with your spouse. A dream where the enemy begins to torment, a snake or a spider begins to choke you and you wake up in a pool of sweat. It's not just a dream, it's the enemy sowing a tear while you're sleeping. And prior to, you know, seeing these things in our church, we just simply would ignore. But now we know when you wake up and you realize something was sown in your sleep, you pull it out by the roots and you say, the devil, you're a liar and you're not going to invade my life through my sleep. Can somebody say amen? One third of your life you will spend sleeping. Most of you will have four dreams during one night. And the enemy likes to slip things in into our life. There was a gentleman who I've heard of, he's in Tri-Cities, that one day somebody in the house that he had committed suicide in one room. It was a bedroom. It was a master bedroom. And this person was tired of life and committed suicide in that house. Any person who lived in that house, and there's three that lived, and any couple that stays in that bedroom gets divorced. Three cases that stayed got divorced. Now he moved in into that house. Well, he's divorced too. Except now, every night, the person who committed suicide in that room shows up to him at night. At first, it was just a dream. Then it started to become so real that he puts a chair, wakes up, and the chair is completely on the other side of the room, and things are completely in disorder in the room. And every single night, he feeds that person, talks to that person, and everything, and this man thinks this is completely fine. Ignorance is demonic advantage. The enemy slips things in. Why? Because men and women are ignorant. When they were looking for Jesus who died, and the angels looked at those people and he says, why are you looking for the living among the dead? You shouldn't be looking for somebody who died. You gotta be looking for somebody who lives. When somebody passed away, we grieve for them. We carry a grief. We remember good memories, but there's one thing we must understand. When they're gone, they're gone. And anybody who shows up at night or during the day looks like them, if they did not get raised from the dead and there is no proof, it's the devil and you gotta kick him out. Can somebody say amen? Because we can allow the enemy to come and control our life. I've heard a testimony in Skowen. One lady, her husband died in an accident. She had one son. And what happened is that every night when the husband died, he started to come to her in a dream. And in the dream, he started telling her, come with me. At first, she didn't understand what that meant. And he started coming and talking to her, and she could not have any other marriage and any other relationships. This continued for years and years until their son grew. And one day this husband came and he says, I need to have our son. She says, yeah, go ahead, have our son. He says, I'm going to take him with me. He's going to come with me. She says, fine with me. She says that in the dream. In the morning, son falls in the gutter and dies for no reason. The doctors examined him and they said, there is no way that kind of space could create physical death and there is no injuries on him. He, unexplainable death. He passed away. A few months later, the same husband comes in a dream to her and says, you are coming with me too. Cold chills went through her skin and she realized, this is not a joke and this is not my husband. And she realized, I love you, but I don't want to die in a gutter. So she runs to the church and sees there in the church, Prophet T.B. Joshua points to her direction and he says, there's a woman here, your husband died, and he says, your child died and your husband tells you to come with him. It's not your husband. He said, your husband's gone. He says, it's the devil, and when you come, God's gonna break that. When he prayed for her, she came back with the testimony. Says, now I can remarry and that husband is no longer there. We must not be ignorant when Satan wants you to sleep in your mind so he can slip things in when you sleep. And therefore, when you wake up in the morning and you had a nightmare or you had something, listen, don't just rush into the day because Satan wants to destroy your day by affecting your night. Open your Bible, read a few scriptures, and you tell the devil, pack your bags and get out of my day in Jesus' name. Can somebody say amen? There's another thing that we must understand is that many times Satan likes to use our ignorance when it comes to spoken words or curses that's spoken over people's lives. For example, when somebody says something over you repeatedly as a young child, it eventually becomes true. Sometimes when a baby is born in the womb or a baby is conceived in the womb and they did not plan that baby and the mother continuously say, man, this baby is going to be a burden. What am I going to do? I don't have enough money. And they continuously say, we don't want this baby. This baby grows up with a demon rejection that torments all this baby's life because this baby was spoken words that affect this baby's life. There was one husband and wife. They had a problem. The problem was that the wife couldn't cook. She couldn't cook at all. And when she did cook, the husband would always get food poisoned. He got so fed up with her that he told her this. He said, I am sick of your cooking. And he says, you know what? You're good at everything, but in cooking, you're stupid. He says, you will never be able to cook. He kept saying that and saying to her. And eventually, because of this issue and a few others, they got divorced. Years later, this husband comes to one church. And he always has problem with eating. He either has diarrhea, he either throws up, he has problem with digestion. As he comes for the pastor to pray for him, for this problem of digestion, the pastor sees a picture and he says, I see you pronounced words over yourself many times that I am sick to my stomach. He says, oh yeah, he says, my first wife, she made me sick. He said, until we break that word spoken over your life, you will never be healed. And he says, that woman that you said she'll never cook, you know what? She could never cook for the rest of her life until those words get broken over her. Yeah. You know what they did? They prayed for him. They broke those words and the problem was gone. We must understand the words that were spoken over our lives, they have power. If somebody spoke over your life that you're foolish, you're stupid, and you will go to school and you said, I'll prove you wrong. Remember one thing, you will never prove them wrong until you break the power of those words over your life. Until you reject those words, says, you know what, I love you, so and so, but those words are not going to be true in my life, in Jesus' name. Can somebody say amen? Another way the enemy slips in into our life in the area of our ignorance is in the area of unnatural sex. In our culture, they give condoms now in school to help people have safe sex. And a condom may protect you from a certain sexual transmitted disease, but a condom will never protect you from a heartbreak and from a demon. We must understand, the Bible says that he who sleeps with the harlot is one spirit with the harlot. When you sleep with someone, you're not just sleeping with their body, you are sleeping with their soul and you are sleeping with their spirit. And they most likely don't have a Holy Spirit if they're sleeping with you and you're not married. So whatever spirit you are getting, that spirit is not from Jesus. And many people must realize is that when a sexual intercourse takes place, that this is not just fun and pleasure, but this is also a time where the enemy likes to use that to infiltrate people's lives, to attack their lives. Same thing happens with pornography. When many people get into that, they little do they realize is the enemy slips in and comes into their life and begins to attack them. Some of you remembered when there was a little guy here who we were praying for deliverance a while ago, and he had a lot of demons that were attacking his life. And one thing that was happening to him is he was obsessively addicted to Paris Hilton porn videos. He was coming to church and he had this secret addiction. He was addicted to it. He watched it. He had every single thing that he could find illegally online. And when we would pray for him, and he would just, the demon would manifest and the demon enter into his life because of watching pornography. And when he would destroy that, go back home, everything is fine. And of course, then he would like, man, I missed that. Watch it more, come back and manifest again. And that's how the cycle continued for months because the man refused to give up pornography. You must understand, pornography is not just cute, naked girls. Pornography, there's a demon behind it. Any person who watches it, a demon will attack their life. We've seen this in our own church. When even some people in our church that I will not mention names who went to the Skowen and who were good people, served God, never had a girlfriend in their life. I mean, tried to seek God but slipped into pornography. And when the anointing of God touched them, the demon spoke out that it entered through pornography. You don't want another demon on your plate. We want less of them and more of the Holy Spirit. And the way Satan comes in many times is saying pornography, well, all men watch pornography. You think Jesus watched it? You think apostles did before the Holy Ghost came? Of course not. Not all men watch it. It's the lie of the devil. The devil watches it and he wants you to watch it. That's what the truth. Can somebody say amen? And we have to reject that. We have to come against it. I'll just mention one more thing that the enemy uses to slip in. And that thing is dishonor to parents. We must understand, when we dishonor our parents, we open the door for a curse in our life. Satan slips a curse into your soil when you disrespect your parents. This is not to scare or threaten nobody, but this is to tell you that the first time it happened in the Bible, when a guy made fun of his dad because his dad became drunk and, well, laid naked in his tent, and his son came and started making fun of him and says, hey, come guys, take a look at this. If this would have been in the 21st century, he would have taken a picture of it and posted on Instagram. That's exactly what it means when he brought two of his brothers and he shared it. He says, hey, this is so funny. And as they were laughing about him, when the dad came back, and come on, getting drunk and getting naked in your tent, that's really bad. But when the dad came back to sobriety, he looks at his son and a curse was pronounced on the son who disrespected his dad. And then the rest of his descendants lived in that curse. We must understand, when you honor your parents, something happens. You push away the devil from your field to sow anything bad. When you dishonor your parents, even when they are wrong, even if what they're saying is not really, it doesn't really sync or click with you, but you still dishonor them, something happens. Satan slips in a curse. Later on, you can have more degrees than a thermometer and still have be broke. And later on, you can have so much wisdom that you can amaze everybody and still never make it. Why? Because Satan slipped a seed. But in this church today, the reason why we're listening to testimonies and we watch testimonies is for the reason. It's because when somebody gets free from the devil, they get free from the demon. You get free from ignorance. When somebody gets delivered from Satan, we get delivered from our ignorance. That's why the enemy doesn't want us to see deliverances, and that's why the enemy doesn't want us to have deliverances in the church. Why? Because not only people get free of demons, people also get free from ignorance. Because when a person sees that a demon under the fire of the Holy Ghost begins to confess that they entered through pornography, and you look, he's like, man, I ain't looking at pornography anymore. The devil is a liar. Now throw away the computer straight into pit of hell. When you see that the demon says that I entered into his life because of nightmare or because of this, you're like, man, next time when you have a nightmare, I mean, you're going to be walking around with the Bible all around your house. Why? Because his deliverance got him free from a demon and it got you free from ignorance. Can somebody say amen? You know, when last Sunday I was watching a person in ministry of TB Joshua who for 3 years was a practicing homosexual. And the way he got into homosexuality was very interesting. He went to the pool where a lot of guys were there. Didn't notice much. Goes to sleep. And in a dream, he sees himself in the same pool with other guys, naked. And he gets to practice homosexuality with them in the dream. He wakes up and he doesn't know nothing about spiritual world. He thinks, oh wow, that's kind of weird. And he started to notice these desires that the guys could be cute for no reason. And he doesn't know nothing about the devil. I mean, just a dream, desires, plus, I mean, the greatest country in the world, America, thinks that it's completely normal and it's actually celebrated. Why not? He just goes with it, and he doesn't have a boyfriend because he's engaged to a fiance. Next thing that happens, he and his fiance begin to have problems. He doesn't like her no more. She doesn't understand him. Girls are complicated. And so he breaks up an engagement. And at that point, a friend in a male gender comes along and brings him comfort. And comfort leads to more comfort and leads to whatever he's seen in the dream. In 3 years, a man begins to practice homosexuality. He comes to church on Sunday, not to be free from homosexuality. He has other issues, financial. He comes, God, give me breakthrough. And as he is there, a wise man touches him and a demon speaks out, said, I made him gay. And the wise man says, stop this nonsense. He says, how did you enter his life? He said, through the dream. He says, what did you do to him? He says, I made him love men, not women. Commands the spirit to leave. The man falls on the floor, gets up. 3 weeks later, comes back to church and Prophet TB Joshua says, so how you doing? He said, number one, I stopped having dreams of sleeping with other men. Number two, he says, I think girls are very beautiful. Now, you can say all you want to say about this issue. But when you watch a testimony, you look at this issue differently. Why? Because deliverance delivers a man from a demon and delivers you from ignorance. Because Satan's advantage is our ignorance. Can somebody say amen? And God wants us to be free from ignorance so we can live in influence for the glory of God.